Good afternoon, Wonder. Let us have a look into functional block of digital signal processing system. You can see, as we saw already, the most of the signals that we encounter in daily life are mostly analog signals. For example, speech is one-dimensional analog signal, function of time, air pressure variations as a function of time, and picture, that's also function of two-dimensional space, that's also analog in nature. In order to process with the help of digital signal processors, we need to convert those analog signals into digital signals first. Once we convert it into digital signal, then we can try to process those signals with the help of digital signal processors. And if you want, you can reconstruct back to our required analog signal by passing through analog reconstruction filter. That's part of our plan. Let's have a look into this functional block diagram. Here, x dash of t corresponds to input signal. For example, just consider analog speech signal. Let's consider x dash of t is an analog speech signal. If you are expecting this one to be electrical signal, what do you need to do? Is there any missing in this particular thing? Something is missing, right? Which block is missing here? I want to convert my speech signal into electrical signal. Here x dash of t corresponds to electrical signal, x prime of t. What I need to use for that one?
Transducers.
I need to use transducer, right? I can go for microphone in order to convert that air pressure variations into electrical signals. Once I convert it into electrical signal, that I can apply to amplifier. I need amplifier also. First, I'll try to record with the help of a microphone, and in order to process that with the help of my digital signal processor, I may need to amplify that signal also. That amplification part also required. First, I'll try to amplify that signal. This is amplified version x of t. And why you require anti-aliasing filter? Is there any guess? In the quiz one, we have seen this, right? Anti-aliasing filter. What should be that filter?
It's a low-pass filter.
Yes, that should be low-pass filter with a cutoff frequency of fs by 2, right? Where fs is the sampling rate. The cutoff frequency of this low-pass filter, analog low-pass filter, is fs by 2, where fs is the sampling rate. That's the cutoff frequency for this low pass filter. Once you do this one, once you pass through anti-aliasing filter, then you can try to pass through ADC, analog to digital conversion. Input to this one is analog signal, because it's just amplified version followed by filtered version. We're applying this to analog low pass filter. That means whatever we are going to get here, that corresponds to analog once again. That analog signal can't be processed directly with the help of DSP. We need to convert that into digital format. For that, we are passing that through ADC, analog to digital conversion. Suppose my sampling rate used in this particular block is 10,000 samples per second. Then up to what frequency I can allow?
5 kHz.
Up to 5 kHz I can allow, right? That's the reason I am using a low pass filter with a cutoff frequency 5 kHz, fs by 2. Based on this fs, I'll try to plan for this cutoff frequency for low pass filter. When this converted to digital format, that can be processed with the help of digital signal processor. For example, my task can be removal of noise. Suppose your x of t is not actual signal. X of t equals to S of t plus N of t. S of t is your actual signal and corrupted by some noise, N of t. At least with the help of, if this is a speech signal band limited to 3.5 kilohertz, then at least I can go for equivalent digital low pass filter with a cutoff frequency of 3.5 kilohertz. I can plan for equivalent digital low pass filter here, and I can try to remove that out of band noise at least. The noise outside 3.5 kilohertz can be removed with the help of this digital low pass filter. Once I remove that noise, I can try to reconstruct that with the help of analog reconstruction filter that we are going to see now. That's part of our plan. Is one of the application of this one is you can try to remove noise, or if there is any disturbance that you can remove. And one more thing already saw is channel equalization. Suppose if your actual transmitted signal is s of t, but you received s of t convolution with h of t, where h of t is the impulse response of your channel, then if I want to get back to my actual signal, then I need to design inverse filter, right? I need to design inverse filter hi of t impulse response in such a manner that h of t convolution with hi of t should be equals to, yeah, what should be that one? What is the property of inverse system? Suppose my channel impulse response is h of t, then what should be, how to select hi of t, where hi of t means impulse response of inverse system.
Product should be equal to 1, sir.
Okay, product should be 1 means that in the time domain there should be delta of t, right? That should be impulse. It means I need to design my system, inverse system, in such a manner that h of t linear convolution with hi of t equals to delta of t, or some delay also acceptable. In general, you can't get directly delta of t. You may get delta of t minus tau after convolution. The delay might be acceptable, right? Suppose my actual signal is s of t, and after this inverse system, I got s of t minus 10 seconds. Is it okay or any mistake is there in that one? Okay, I'll ask a question. What I'm saying is, this is my actual signal, s of t, but after passing through some channel or some medium, this got corrupted by channel. For example, this is LTA system with impulse response of the channel, and I received x of t equals to linear convolution with h of t. This is what I received. Now what's my plan is, I want to design a system, inverse system, h of t, in such a manner that I am going to get output as s of t minus tau. For example, t equals to 10 seconds. Will you lose any information with this? Or is it okay? This final output. This is my actual input, s of t. I want to receive something similar to s of t. Is it okay if I got like this? S of t minus 10 instead of s of t?
No, sir.
No. Yes, sir. See, that's okay. For example, let's consider this is a speech signal. It's on speech signal. Due to channel, this got modified somehow. And what you are doing is you are trying to apply inverse system in such a manner that you are going to get back to your actual speech signal. Do you think this entire processing will be done in zero time? There is some processing. Some processing is going to take space here, right? Some processing you are doing, signal passing. Some inverse system, you're passing this one through this one. Definitely some time will be taken by this system, right? That's why you won't get s of t directly after passing through inverse system. You are going to get delayed version of s of t. S of t minus 10, for example. This 10 seconds might be delay incurred in this entire process, because that should travel through the medium, that may take some time, right? Or propagation delay. And after that, you are going to process that with the help of inverse system. Okay, that might take some time, right? That delay will be this one, this whole delay introduced by this thing. There is no issue with this one, right? Instead of listening to that particular song, for example, at this time, instead of listening to that song, you are trying to listen to that song after 10 seconds. You are listening to that song or you are listening to that information with some delay. That's not at all an issue. There won't be any loss in information, right? You are receiving the same information, but with some delay. That's it. Okay, what about television broadcasting? Do you think that live broadcasting is there, right? For example, if you consider live broadcasting of ICC World Cup final thing, Cricket World Cup, do you think there won't be any delay between that actual match and your television display?
It will be there, sir.
Definitely there will be delay, right? There will be so much of processing. You are trying to, nowadays most of you are using digital TVs only, right? No one is using that old models, that analog direct one. You are using some digital kind of thing, right? That should be converted to digital, that should be compressed, and that should be encoded with encryption. There will be some encryption, and there will be some error control coding. There is some noise in the channel that will try to be immune with respect to the channel. Yeah, so much of processing will be done in between. And not only that one, there is a transmission delay, right? For example, if you are receiving signals from the satellite, yeah, what can be the delay? Can one of you answer? Let me consider the broadcasting satellite. Someone is capturing that video of that cricket match, and they are trying to broadcast, they are trying to transmit up to the satellite, and from the satellite that's coming back to your dish. For example, geostationary satellite. For example, but in general, you want the geostationary satellite for this purpose. You'll try to have some low Earth orbit satellites. You won't go for geostationary satellites for this purpose. Let's assume that it's an extreme case. Okay, Mohan, can you turn off your mic? Okay, yeah, that's fine. Let me assume that roughly 64,000 kilometers. And this is also 64,000 kilometers, right? From Earth to geostationary satellite. Then how much delay will be there? This propagation delay. This is your receiver. This is your transmitter. It will receive this one and retransmit back to ground. Then what is the velocity of electromagnetic signal? 3 into 10 power 8 meters per second, right? Now, if you want to compute the delay taken by just this propagation delay, that will be 2 times 64,000 kilometers, right? 64,000 into 10 power 3 divided by, because this plus this is the total traveling distance by that electromagnetic signal, right? Divided by velocity of that electromagnetic signal, 10 power 8. 3 and 3, 6, 300, right? 2 into 64 by 300, that many seconds. This many seconds delay is there just in propagation only. In addition to this, you are having that processing, right? Signal processing delay. Converting to digital, followed by compression, followed by encryption, followed by error control coding, all these things. And you should try to do the reverse process at your receiver once again. That will take some delay, right? That means Some delay is acceptable, right? Delay is acceptable here. There is no issue with this kind of delays. You are getting back to actual signal only, but with some delay. This is what our plan. After inverse system, we are expecting the same signal with some delay. Some delay is tolerable, that's it. And you can try to have a look into this. If this is analog signal, input is analog signal like speech signal and such things, this will be converted to digital first with the help of this setup. After that will be processed by DSP. And after that, if you want to get back to analog signal only once again, then you do digital to analog conversion followed by analog reconstruction filter followed by some amplification if needed. That's what you are doing. But there might be some signals which are already digital in nature. Can you give me example of such things?
Recorded.
Yeah,
voice.
Already recorded one. That might be there, right? Already recorded version is there. You are going to process that recorded signal. Or some text messages. They are directly available in digital format only. Each and every letter corresponds to 16-bit number, right? Some 16-bit sequence, as we have seen earlier, some standard for that. Such thing can be processed with the help of DSP straight away. And you may not require digital to analog conversion for them. That's not always required, right? This is the complete setup for our DSP system. And let's have a look into this block, ADC, analog to digital conversion. Input to this one should be analog. Output we are going to expect it digital. We want to convert this analog signal to digital signal. Yes, let's consider this. What we are going to do here is analog to digital conversion block, ADC. Input to this one should be analog. X of T, for example. And output should be digital format. Output should be digital. Then this can be processed with the help of our digital system. It's possible. In general, you'll try to print digital in this format, x of n notation. You'll try to go with this notation, x of n, digital notation. First, you need to sample, right? For example, let's consider some signal like this. Here's some signal, x of t. This is time versus x of t. We need to sample this first. Let me start sampling at zero, for example. I like to sample at uniform intervals or regular intervals. And let me call this duration as TS. TS is the sampling period, right? TS is the sampling period and sampling rate FS corresponds to 1 by TS. This is 0, this is TS, this is 2TS, 3TS, 4TS like this and so on. It means our first step is X of T converted to X of NTS, the sampled version where N is integer, N belongs to Z, N is some integer. Here t can be any real value. It's continuous time, right? This is always multiples of ts, integer multiples of ts. N can be negative or n can be positive. For example, there might be minus ts, minus 2ts, up to minus nts and so on. This can extend this side also. Just for representation, I have written like this. Is it a digital signal or sample signal? This is analog signal.
Sample signal.
This is discrete time, but this is not digital. This is a discrete time signal, but not digital signal. We will try to convert into digital signal. These are the notation that we are going to follow. Digital signal. This one is the notation for digital signal. This is with the help of sampling. This can be done with the help of sampling circuit. And this one to this conversion will be done with the help of quantizer plus encoder. There will be quantization plus encoding block, which will try to convert these samples, discrete time samples, into digital format. Digital means in the form of zeros and ones, the sequence of zeros and ones, bit sequence. So that this can be stored in the memory, right? Digital memory. Quantizer plus encoder. Okay, I'll try to ask a question. Let me consider that I have minus 1, minus 0.5, 0.5, and plus 1. I have four different voltage levels. I want to assign each of them with a different bit sequence. How many bits are required?
Two
is enough, right? Yeah, I can have the unique one-to-one mapping like this, 10 and 11. You can arrange them in any order. There is no issue with this one. It's just one way to encode them. Two bits is enough to encode them, right? Suppose if I have 8 different voltage levels, then how many bits are required?
Three,
right? Three is okay for me, right? Yeah, it means I required log. Yeah, what should be that one? If n corresponds to number of voltage levels, number of voltage levels, then how many bits I require to represent each level? Log n base 2. If you want to cross check, there are 4 levels in this case. N equal to 4 means 2 bits is enough, right? Log 4 base 2. That's 2. If n equal to 8, 8 levels means log 8 base 2. Log 8 base 2 means 3, right? 3 bits is enough. Like that, right? If n equal to 1024, then how many bits I require?
10.
10, right? 10 bits I require. 10 bit sequence can be enough, right? Okay, that is fine. Let's assume that we have that sampled sequence x of nts, right? We have sampled sequence x of nts after sampling, just after sampling. For example, x of t, value of x of t belongs to minus 1 to 1, minus 1 to 1, any real value between minus 1 to 1. For example, the x of t will fluctuate between minus 1 to 1. How many possible values are there for your x of t? Let's consider some randomly some t1 time. That can be anywhere between minus 1 to 1. Then how many possible voltage levels are there for this? See, my x of t1 can be, according to this, my x of t1 can be 0. That can be 0.1, or that can be 0.0001, and that can be 10 power minus 9, or that can be 1, that can be 0.9, that can be 0.0092, That can be anything like this. This can take any one of these values. Then how many possibilities are there for my x of t1? How many possible voltage levels? See, there are how many real values between minus 1 to 1? How many real values? Okay, infinite, right? Yeah, they already answered. Infinite, uncountably infinite number, right? If you are having uncountably infinite number of levels, then the number of bits required to represent each sample corresponds to log n base 2. Suppose if n tends to infinity, implies what happens to b? B also tends to infinity, right? Log infinite base 2. Infinity can be written like this. Do you agree this? 2 power infinity is also same as infinity. Because see, anything greater than 1 whole power infinity equals to infinity if a greater than 1. Suppose, what is 0.1 whole power infinity? What is the approximate value? Point 0.1 whole power infinity. What? 0, right? Yeah, it's good. That's 0. 1.1 whole power infinity. That's infinity. Anything more than 1. To do this one, you will approach to infinity. You are going to get like infinity. Then is it possible or not? Is it possible to assign a bit sequence for each of these samples? Suppose this is varying from minus 1 to 1. Is it possible to assign a unique bit sequence for each of these samples? There are infinite possibilities. I need to go for infinite bits to represent each of those samples in the unique manner, right? Infinite bits means that's not possible, right? You can't even imagine, right? You can represent each of the samples with the help of only finite bits. But with the help of infinite bits, you can't even store, you can't even imagine that one, right? That's the reason to go for quantization. Let me have a look into this. That's the reason for this quantizer. Just after sampling, you won't convert this into bit sequence. Encoder will help to convert sample to bit sequence. But if you directly convert into bit sequence, the problem you are going to get is there are infinitely many possible voltage levels that can be taken by each sample. Because infinite real numbers between minus 1 to 1, at least in our example. You can't represent straight away, right? So what's your plan is? You will try to quantize that first. Quantization means some round off kind of thing. After that, you can go for encoder. For example, let's have a look into, the same example. Let me consider the voltages from minus 1 volt to plus 1 volt. Minus 1 volt and plus 1 volt. Actually, there are infinite real numbers or infinite possible real voltages here. If you want to go directly with that one, you require infinite bits to represent each of those samples. That's not feasible at all, right? That's why you are going to go for round off or quantization. What's our plan is, we'll try to divide this into some subparts. Let's assume that we are trying to partition this into 8 parts. This is just an example. 8 parts means, what is this gap? How much gap is there? 8 parts means? 1.
0.125.
0.125, right? Because this entire gap is 1 minus of minus 1. That is 2, right? 2 divided by 8. 8 partitions you want to do. This will be 0.125, right? 0.125 or 0.25?
0.25 से.
इज 0.25 राइट. दिस विल बी 0.25. 1 2 3 4 7 8 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. I just partitioned into 8 equal parts in this case. Uniform quantization. There will be some non-uniform quantizer. You are going to study in digital communications. Let me call this like delta. Here delta corresponds to 0.25. What's my plan is already have a level like this. Center is exactly at the center between two levels. Is round off level like that you can think. Can someone tell me what is this voltage value? See -1 + δ/2 right. This is delta. It's exactly half of that one, 0.25. And this is exactly center of that one. This is exactly center of that one. Like that you can think. This corresponds to 1 − δ/2. 1 − 0.125. And plus delta added to this plus delta. Like that you can think. Like this we are doing. For example, if my sample is this one. This is my sample. Yeah, let me have another color for this. This is my sample. Then how to process this? I want to round up that sample to nearest one, a nearest level. Yeah, what is the nearest level to this? This is a nearest one, right? I like to round up this one to this one, this value. That's part my plan. It's a round off error. This part corresponds to round off error. I will try to round off this sample to nearest voltage level. These are the quantization levels. You can call them like quantization levels. This blue color. Quantization levels. We will try to round off that sample value to nearest quantization level value. Suppose if my sample is this one, then will you try to round off this one to first or second one? Which one? This is first one.
Last one.
Second one, right? This level is nearer to this one. As compared to this one, this level is nearer to this. It means if this sample is falling between this black line and this black line, I'll try to round off to this blue line. Similarly, if this sample falling between this black color and this black color line, I'll try to round off to this one. If some level is falling between this and this, I'll try to round off to this level. Likewise, you can think, if my sample is somewhere here, between this and between this, I'll try to round off to this center value. And this is a round off error. This much error I am getting, right? After round off. For example, yeah, this is my sample. And I like to round off to nearest one, this one, right? This is a round off error I am going to get, this part. It's a quantization error. This error is called as quantization error. Due to quantization, you are getting error, right? Now, how many possible voltage levels are there in this? We have 8, right? In our example, we have just 8 levels. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. After round off, we are going to have only 8 possible voltage levels, n equal to 8. Then what should be the number of bits we require?
3,
right? Just 3 bits is enough to represent each of those rounded off samples, right? If you want to directly represent each of those samples, we may require infinite samples. That's why you are going for round off or quantization. But due to quantization, there is a quantization error, right? Which is not reversible. This is irreversible process. Irreversible. Irreversible means, what is the meaning of that one? Suppose if I rounded off this sample to this.
Cannot be undone.
And you can't reconstruct back to this one, right? Because actual sample can be anywhere between this one and this one. Actual sample might be anywhere between this one and this one. There are infinitely many such samples, infinitely many such possible samples. And you are rounding up to only one sample, right? Many to one mapping. If you do many to one mapping, you can't get back to your actual signal, right? You'll always get with some error, that's it. That means this quantization error is reversible. You can't reverse this process. If that noise is there, you can't do anything with that noise. You can't remove that noise at all. This will always be there. You can't remove that. That's the issue you are going to get if you do quantization. If you want to reduce this quantization error, is it okay if I increase to 16 levels? Is it okay? Can I reduce my quantization error? Okay, do you agree this? I'll go for 16 levels.
Yes, sir. It is better than 8 bits.
It's better than that one, right? Yeah. If you want to have clarity over that, let me go blindly with 2 levels. Minus 1, 1. I have only 2 levels first. And second case, I am going for 4 levels. 1, 2, 3, 4. Minus 1 to 1. 4 levels. Just compare these two cases. Here n equals to 2. Here n equals to 4. Yeah, let's go for our actual level. This is the round off or quantization levels. These are the quantization levels that we are going to consider. Now let's have a look into this one. Highest possible error we are going to get here is how much error? For example, this is my sample. I'll round off to this one.
0.5.
This is the highest possible error I am going to get, right? This corresponds to 0.5, highest possible error. And what about this one? What can be the highest possible error here? This is the highest possible error. See, 0.25, right? See, 0.25. This error corresponds to 0.5. Highest possible error. This error corresponds to highest possible error, 0.25. This can be anywhere between minus 0.5 to 0.5 error, quantization error between this one. Here the quantization error for the particular sample can be anywhere between minus 0.25 to 0.25. It depends on your sample, right? It's a range of quantization error. This is a range of quantization error here. That's the problem you are going to get with quantization. But without quantization, you can't convert that into digital format. You can see in some of the books, they'll try to club these two together. Sampling, after that, quantization plus encoder together. By default, if they write encoder after sampler, by default, you can think that encoder includes quantization also. They'll try to match these two blocks together in some cases. Now, you can try to encode each of those samples with the help of 3 bits, right? In our example case, you can try to represent, for example, this with 3 zeros, 001. 0101 0110 1001 1101 1101. You can try to represent as an unique bit sequence for each of the quantization levels, right? With the help of 3 bits, you can represent them. That's what we are doing here. You can try to have a look into this one. This is analog signal, sampled version of that one. Is sampling with a period of TS, where TS equals to 1 by FS, and you should what should the highest frequency allowed, highest analog frequency allowed for this?
FS by 2.
Yeah, FS by 2. Before this, you should assume that there is anti-aliasing filter with cutoff frequency FS by 2. And this is with TS, where TS equals to 1 by FS. This sample gap is TS. And you will try to round off that one with the help of quantizer. And after that, you can try to assign any code for those levels. In this way, let me convert this into bit sequence. Can you just tell me the bit sequence here? Yeah, you can try to have a look into this. This is a bit sequence we are going to get here. You can see this first sample is nearer to this level, right? This voltage level, where this is assigned with 111. This is 111. The second sample also 111. 111, 111. And the star sample is nearer to 001 level, right? It's assigned with 001. And this fourth sample corresponds to nearby 010 level. 010 will be in this way already encoded. You are trying to convert this analog signal into bit sequence with the help of this ADC, analog to digital conversion. But the constraint you need to follow is the maximum frequency of this analog signal should be less than FS by 2, where FS is the sampling rate of this circuit. With this constraint, and you are trying to round off that with the help of quantizer, right? It means some quantization noise added by yourself only, where that is irreversible process. In this way, I'll try to convert analog signal to equivalent digital format. Now this can be stored in memory, right? Bit 1 and bit 0s can be stored in the memory. This can be processed with the help of a digital signal processor, because this is in the form of binary, right? Ones and zeros format. You can do manipulations, additions, subtraction, multiplication, whatever you want, you can do on top of these samples. Just construct this like some number. Construct this like some number, and you can try to process that. Do multiplication by constant, or add something, or subtract something, divide something, whatever you want, you can do with the help of that digital signal processor, right? Yeah, I can have a look into this later. Let's have a look into this example. The problem comes when your input signal frequency is above FS by 2. If that is above FS by 2, you are going to get aliasing effect. Let's have a look into that effect here. This corresponds to 1 hertz signal. This is 1 hertz signal. And this corresponds to 5 hertz signal. And this time is 1 second. This is 0 seconds. This is 1 second. This is 0 second. This is 1 second. If that is one hertz signal, how many cycles you can find in 1 second?
Only one cycle.
Only one, right? If that is 5 hertz, you are going to find 5 cycles in that 1 second duration, right? 0 to 1 second, 1 cycle. 0 to 1 second, 5 cycles you are finding. Now, let us try to sample that. Let me start sampling at this point. How many samples per second we have taken here?
Five.
Four. This is not five. This will come under next one. Yeah, I'll try to explain why that will come under next one. If I extend that signal, Let me extend further. Yeah, up to 2 cycles. This is 0 to 1 second. The 2 seconds. I started doing sampling from this point, first sample, and this is my second sample. See my third sample. See my fourth sample. My fifth sample. My sixth sample. Seventh. Eighth sample. Ninth sample. Like that. Just exclude this one. Excluding this t equal to 1, we are having 4 samples, right? This will count in the next cycle. 1, 2, 3, 4. No, 1, 2, 3, 4. And this sample will count in the next cycle. Like that, you can consider. We have only 4 samples. We have 4 samples. This will come under next cycle. 4 samples per second. See, if you have doubt, simply do TS equals to 1 by FS, right? TS equals to 1 by FS means 1 by 4. 1 by 4 means 0.25 seconds. The 0, next sample is 0.25. Next sample is 0.5. Next sample time is 0.75. And this one is 1, right? It means for every 1 by 4, 1 by 4 equals to 0.25, you are sampling this one. In that way, you can, yeah, have clarity over that. Okay, that's fine. 4 samples per second we are considering. Is there any issue with this one? Are you following that sampling criteria? We required sample that input frequency should be less than or equals to FS by 2, right? Is it okay here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, there is no issue with this, right? Because FS by 2 equals to 2 hedges. This is 1 hedge. 1 hedge is less than 2 hedges. There is no issue with this. Is there any issue with 5 hedges? I am doing the same sampling. With FS equals to 4 samples per second. Every 0.25, I am sampling this one. This 5 hedge signal is above FS by 2, right? Because FS by 2 equals to 2 hedges. See, more than FS by 2. According to our theory, earlier theory, there should be some aliasing effect, right? This high frequency should behave like a low frequency signal. Let's have a look into that once. This is after reconstruction. Okay, you can try to see this. Is there any difference between these samples and these samples? Okay, forget about this down figure. Just look into this figure. First sample is 0. This is also 0. Second sample is 1. Let's consider this is 1, this is minus 1. So 1. What about second sample here? Yeah, what is this value? See, this is also 1, right? This is 1, this is minus 1. And third sample is 0. Here, third sample is 0. And fourth sample is minus 1. Here, fourth sample is minus 1. Fifth sample is 0. And fifth sample is 0. Okay, these two are identical, right? The samples are identical. You can try to see. You got some sample sequence. And both of them are having the same sampling period. This is 0.25 gap. 0.25 gap, 0.25 gap, 0.25 gap. Same thing for this. Head to head 0.25. This to this 0.25 gap. It means for every 0.25 seconds gap, you are going to get identical samples, right? For this and this. Identical samples means, suppose if I gave you only these 5 samples to you, and if I ask you, whether that is from 1 hedge or whether that is from 5 hedge, can you answer to that one? Is it possible? Is it possible? See, what's my question is, I'll try to give some samples, 5 samples to you, as follows. This is time versus samples. See, 0, at 0, that is 0. And at 0.25, it means at TS, where TS equals to 0.25. That is 1. And at 2 TS, that is 0. And at 3ts, that is minus 1. And at 4ts, that is 0. I gave you these sample sequences. From this, can you guess what is your actual frequency? Can you say it is 1 hertz? Or can you say it is 5 hertz? Which one is true?
No, sir.
You can't say anything, right? You can't say anything. Because both of them are giving the same sample sequences, exactly identical. That's the problem you are going to get with this one. If you are not satisfying maximum frequency less than or equal to fs by 2, if you won't satisfy that condition, then you'll be in trouble. Such kind of problems you are going to face. This high frequency signal is behaving like low frequency signal. It means 5 hertz is identical to 1 hertz signal. If you do this kind of sampling, that's the issue with not satisfying that condition, f less than fs by 2. Both looks identical. If you try to reconstruct this one, you are going to get 1 hertz only after reconstruction. If you reconstruct this, you are going to get 1 hertz. If you reconstruct this, you are going to get 1 hertz only. With the help of our reconstruction filter, which we are going to discuss later, you are going to get identical thing. It means high frequency is behaving like a low frequency, right? If you won't satisfy that condition, that frequency, if that is above fs by 2, that particular frequency will behave like some low frequency signal, which will be under fs by 2. Like that will feel. This is called as aliasing effect. The frequency fs by 2 is called as folding frequency. And you can have a look into this one. Here are some of the standards for sampling rate. International Telecommunication Union speech coding or decoding standards. Here the sampling rate is 8000 samples per second. 8000 samples per second. And sampling period will be 1 by fs, right? 125 microseconds. In general, what is the band of frequencies per speech?
4 kilohertz.
4, right? See, yeah, as I said, that might be up to 3.5 kilohertz also. In general, the dominant frequency might be up to 3.5 kilohertz. But we don't have ideal filters with us. We don't have ideal filters with us, right? For example, what I'm going to say is, this is my speech signal. Let me have ADC where the sampling rate I am using is, okay, forget about this. Let me go with 7 first. 7000 samples per second is the sampling rate. For example, I felt that up to 3.5 kilohertz, speech will have dominant components. Let me assume that this might be my spectrum, rough spectrum. Just assume for some speech signal, I got a spectrum as follows. Like that you can imagine, 300 hertz. Let me assume that this is 3.5 kilohertz. After 3.5 kilohertz, this might be somewhat weak, like that you can think. But still some component is there, right? If I won't apply low pass filter, anti-aliasing filter. If I won't apply anti-aliasing filter with a cutoff frequency of, what should be the cutoff frequency here? Based on this.
3.5k.
Yeah, 3.5 kilohertz, right? Suppose if I have ideal low pass filter with me, with 3.5 kilohertz cutoff frequency, I can remove this and I can convert into digital sampling followed by quantization followed by encoding. But do you think this will exist, ideal filters? ideal filter won't exist. They are not practically feasible because they are non-causal systems, ideal filters. You can't implement them. But you can try to implement these kind of filters, some non-ideal filters. These are practical filters. These kind of filters you can implement where the stop band gain is not completely zero. Here the pass band gain is not completely one. This might be nearby one. This might be nearby zero. For example, this might be 0.1 gain in the stop band, gain of above 0.9 in the pass band. Such kind of filters you can design. Because of this non-zero gain in the stop band, after this filtering, you might have spectrum something like this, some rough spectrum. This might be attenuated, no problem, but it's not completely zero. You can have a look into this. It's not becoming complete zero after passing through this filter. This got attenuated somehow up to some level. Now, due to this component above fs by 2, the other frequency components, non-zero frequency components, which are above fs by 2, right? What will happen due to this after sampling? There will be some aliasing effect, right? There will be aliasing effect. These frequency components will try to behave like these frequency components. They too gets overlapped. Such behavior is called as aliasing effect. The frequencies above fs by 2 will behave like frequencies below fs by 2. That mapping we'll try to see in next class. Due to that disturbance or distortion, what you are going to do is you'll try to have some God band. God band means you'll try to design, yeah. Even though you are designing this filter with the 3.5 kHz cutoff frequency, it'll try to have some extra guard band, like a 0.5 kHz guard band. This can be also called a transition band. You can have some extra transition band or guard band at 0.5 kHz. After that, this is almost zero. After 4 kHz, the gain is almost zero. But between 3.5 to 4 kHz, the gain is somewhat reasonable. Might be 0.1 gain like that. So what's our plan is, instead of having this like 7,000, I'll try to make it like 8,000, including this God band up to this. Now, there is no issue for me up to 4 kHz, right? Up to 4 kHz, there is no issue for me. Even I have some small components up to 4 kHz, there is no issue of aliasing effect because my sampling rate is 8 kilo samples per second. Instead of 7, I'll go for 8. In that way, I can plan. Yeah, that is the reason for going to 8 kilo samples per second. You might apply practical low pass filter, anti-aliasing filter with cutoff frequency 3.5 kHz. But due to that non-ideal nature of the filter, you'll try to increase the sampling rate. Instead of 7 kilo samples per second, you can go for 8 kilo samples per second. And wideband telecommunication speech coding standard, 16 kilo samples per second. And you can have a look into this later. Yeah, it's already 1 hour, right? Okay, do we have any doubts? Let's stop recording.